Welcome back, everybody. It's Eastwater Cup 5. It's time for our second quarterfinal, Eloise versus Life Coach. Another member from G2, and who better than Mr. Consistent himself, Tice, who's gotten to the top four of another tournament. How do you do it, Tice?
Well, can't say feeling bad after the win, of course, but yeah. It's a bit rough to like kick your teammate out. That's something you don't want. You practice together. So that's a bit of the sad part, but yeah, I'm happy, really happy advancing to the top four.
Gotcha. And Firebat, how are you looking forward to this series? Eloise versus Life Coach.
I'm excited to see it. I always like seeing, you know, Life Coach series, for example, just because, you know, we always talk about Tice being Mr. Consistent, but I think Life Coach is even more consistent than Tice. He plays in less tournaments and gets similar amounts of top eights. So, like, Life Coach is a player that I think everyone likes watching just because he usually makes the right plays and always performs really well in tournaments. So excited to see him play. And then Eloise, of course, not a lot of people expected her to go this far. And it's always... underdogs are cool to see.
Yeah, she was mentioning that she didn't expect to get this far. You know, I mean, outside of the fact that she knew she'd beat me, but the point is she didn't really think she'd get into the top eight, primarily because she just feels like she's always the underdog compared to some of these players who are always so prominent. Because in C-Story Cup, you do have a pretty good list of killers. You know, you have some people who are just really good. And in DreamHack Opens, you play, you kind of run into some players who are just, you know, there for the casual experience. But in this tournament, it can be pretty likely that you run into just a non-stop threat after threat.
Yeah, there's a lot of really good players here for sure. And actually, before the tournament, I was tweeting about Seed Story Cup, and one of my Twitter followers was like, you better watch out for Eloise, she's going to beat you. And I was like, yeah, I mean, Eloise is a pretty underrated player. I wouldn't be surprised if she's got a pretty good shot. She usually brings Hunter, though, which I think is... like gives her a little bit of a disadvantage when it's in the four decks, not in the five decks. I think in five decks, Hunter's a pretty solid choice. But with the top four decks being the selection for the best of fives, I think Hunter's kind of weak, and she usually brings that. And we see here she didn't bring Hunter and having a lot more success.
Yep.
In the top four decks, anyway.
Yeah, I think Hunter is a really good deck as a fifth one. Like, a lot of people like bringing more up the... like, if you bring up a bit more the mid-range control decks, it favors Hunter so much. A lot of people might go to, like, Rogue or Druid, and then you have, like... pretty decent shots, and yeah, I think it's also for the more, like, we also still have, like, Jackie Chan, for example, advanced, and he has, like, the Nuzzaw Paladins and all this.
Yeah, he's
like,
the hipster.
So it's, like, kind of good to have, like, a Hunter for this for these matchups.
And the Bog Creeper Shaman.
Yeah, man, I fear Hunter like crazy with that deck. Deadly Shot's pretty sick.
Yeah,
kills anything that I play.
Yeah, for sure.
All right, so speaking of Druid, Eloise's fifth deck is Druid.
Druid is one of the most powerful decks right now, but also one of the hardest decks right now, I think. I think out of any deck this tournament, Druid has been misplayed the most, myself included. I've
myself
made some
included.
Mistakes with Druid.
Myself included.
It's not an easy deck to play, but it is by far, like, not by far, but one of the most strong decks in the tournament, in my opinion.
So we by far.
By far.
Druid's done a lot of work for people.
I mean, even people playing it incorrectly, it's done a lot of work for. Playing it optimally is just so difficult.
Myself included.
Mine played.
This is where you guys are joining.
Okay. Like, mine played suboptimally, did not do any work for me.
But it's a bit difficult because with greedy, you can like take a bit. You need to get some greedy approach because you need to like get the value from the deck. But you are also have to be fast. And cards like Innervate, how earlier that you play them, the more value they should get.
And analyzing your hand to know if you want to nourish for cards or for crystals and in the matchups and stuff like that can be a lot tricky. That's where I was mistaken, like not knowing, not being able to correctly identify when crystals was just slightly better than drawing.
So Life Coach here with the Midrange Shaman, one of the few people still bringing the Midrange Shaman, not the Buck Shaman or the Aggro Shaman, no, Midrange Shaman, and still finds here a pretty good opening on the board, I would say, also with the Totem Golem. It's one of the, you don't have like, you play like less one and two drops, so it's nice to have that.
Wow.
Might even be better to Flame Juggler here, set up for that sick Manatide Totem. But overall, I think Midrange Shaman in this particular matchup is... I don't know about Bog Shaman per se. I don't know the stats on it, but I compared to Aggro Shaman, Midrange Shaman, I believe, has a better matchup against Yogg Druid than Aggro Shaman does.
I think that's the popular belief. However, I feel like some players are actually changing their opinion the more they play this matchup, because we've seen this matchup actually several times throughout this weekend.
Okay.
Life Coach's series even too, and the Druid's actually gotten better because they're able to outgrind the Shaman because of things like Nourish. Because of
they
the
run two of them,
because they're playing like, you know, Onyxia and double Ancients of War. It's like that's just a lot of stuff to chew through.
I can see it. I can see it for sure. It's just, though, Druid has no answer to Thunderbluff Valiant, which is so scary. Like, as soon as that comes down and makes totem, if they don't kill it immediately, and how do they kill it? They have to mulch it? Yeah, probably. So if they don't have the answer to that, they just get snowballed out of the game from turn 7 onward.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Also, a big problem for the Shaman, I would say, is now that, like, even Druid has, like, the Living Roots, or they have, like, the tokens. Like, it clears off all the totems all the time for free. Yeah. So, and Shaman just has to, like, get back on board first to, like...
We did it. We're on board.
Yeah, well, like, no, it's not always the case,
you know? Yeah, for sure.
So...
Flame Juggler is an interesting card. It's been a card that's kind of phasing out of a lot of Shaman decks in general. Even aggro Shamans have started cutting, you know, one Flame Juggler at least, and maybe even the second one for Storms, stuff like that. Why do you think Flame Juggler was selected for this tournament in the mid-range variant?
Well, mid-range Shaman has sometimes, Totem Golem is really good at turn two.
Yeah.
But the thing what Totem Golem does, if you're not going first, you don't have anything to follow it up. You have only two mana left. So I think that's one reason to like have the more consistent curve. And yeah, like with, as you see, Living Ruins around, there is the Fiery Bats around, there is the just a lot of 1 HP minions still. And it's a bit of a like you have to hope with it, but still, it's just a solid 2-drop. And there are not many solid 2-drops at the moment.
I like this play by Eloise here, going for the Innervate Coin Nourish for mana. With the Ancient of War in her hand, she assumes she can have the value to follow it up, and she has the Raven Idol, which you can assume you're going to get a pretty decent card from, because you get three choices, so one of the choices is likely to be kind of mana intensive and can fill out your curve a little bit, so...
Yeah. Top deck should also still be good. There are like quite a lot of 9-drops being viable now for the Druid.
Yeah, the only consideration on that turn is, like, is Wrath for 3 better than Wrathing for 1 to try and get that draw? Assuming that likely you have the ability to Hero Power next turn to clean up the minion, you get scared when, like, Feral Spirits comes into the equation, but, yeah, I can't say exactly which one's better, Wrath for 3 or Wrath for 1 is very close.
Oh, Wild Growth kind of fits nicely for the turn 7, or sorry, the 7 mana Ancient of War.
I guess we are looking for Wrathy or something.
Nourish.
I don't see the choices.
Yeah, no choices are presented to us.
It's all mystery.
Kind of like the play from Life Coach, going over the Mana Tide, over the Totem Golem.
Oh, yeah. Get that Mana Tide Totem down. The only way it can die is from a card from hand, because Druid of the Claw is kind of filtered out of the Yogdruids right now. If Druid of the Claw was still in the meta, I imagine he wouldn't be throwing that Mana Tide out there, because charged Druid of the Claw is so painful. But with Druid of the Claw not being in Eloise's Druid deck, the Manatide Totem is most likely going to stick or require the removal of a Wrath, which means the Manatide drew one card and took one card away from your opponent as well as two mana, which is just such an insane amount of value. It's a two
some
for one.
Some people did put Drew the Claws in their decks. I think Ecop put them in and Forsen put them in.
Okay.
Just a few people teched it in.
Sure.
It was interesting. I wasn't expecting Drew the Claw to be in the list. That's why.
Yeah.
So I know it was played, it kind of surprised me. Mm-hmm.
It's a good card. For
it's not
sure.
bad. It's solid.
If your opponent doesn't expect it, it's even better.
I find it a pretty bad card, actually. 5 mana, 4-6? Yeah, it's like, why would I play 5 mana,
Well, you're using
four,
the card
six.
Incorrectly. It's a 5 mana, 4-4 go
fade. Yeah, like, I can see
I feel like you don't really play Drew the Claw in taunt mode. You like when you're putting in your Yogdruid deck, it's usually just to go aggressive and charge.
Yeah, to kill people. It gives you that out of that extra reach at the end, especially if you're running a Roar in your Yogdruid build.
Because then it makes sense.
Any
then
minion sticks,
sense.
You charge it, you Roar, you kill them. So it just gives that factor, which is kind of lost on Yogdruid now. It's turned more into a board control deck.
Thank goodness. I mean, say what you want, but I kind of really enjoy playing Druid these days compared to the days of yore, aka 2 months ago, 3 months ago. Back then, Druid wasn't really that fun to play, nor fun to play against.
I don't know. I
so much options now with Druid. Like, the Mind Keeper is already a card that gives you, like, from the early on, like, you can do so much with
That's
it.
That's why
like,
it's so hard to play.
Yeah. You have, like, all of the Raven Idols are also so interesting. Even Living Roots sometimes, and Rev, and the Fendral makes it, the Teacher, the Power Pill. Like, there are so much approaches you can now do with the deck.
Yeah, definitely one of the most interesting decks in Hearthstone, where you just, like, literally have a bajillion options, as where compared to things like Face Shaman or, you know, Hunter, where you kind of play on curve, go face.
Literally.
Literally.
Bajillion options. Well, you don't have too much options here.
Yeah, not really. Druid.
Just pretty much grab the board as best as you can. 7-7 is pretty hard to
I think you save
against.
The Wild Growth for cycle if you live that long, which is a little ambitious, but...
Ooh.
Got to kill it somehow. You're hoping the trade happens.
Yeah, a bit of a positive attack there.
Yeah. I mean, when you're behind, you kind of have to be optimistic, right? Yeah. Because if you're pessimistic when you're behind, you're just going to keep going down and down.
Looking at that format of 7-7 also doesn't really help there.
Yeah, you just cover it with your hand, and, right?
Yeah.
You can't
Is
really,
that the
man.
Best answer nowadays against it?
Even the best art. Answer to a format of 7-7, just block it with your hand so you can't see it. If you can't see it, it can't see you. How's it going to attack you?
Oh, I like that. It's the same logic of hide and seek.
Yeah,
you know,
exactly.
It's kind of hard to ignore it, though, because even the card's art is just kind of like putting himself out there.
Yeah.
Full naked body and everything.
Well, he's
wearing like
hands
a little jock strap. But,
oh, yeah.
Hmm.
Yeah.
Looking good.
Oh, so you can just remove the board. I don't mind putting Rockbiter and Totem Golem and then just a 7-7 to the face.
I'm not sure about the Totem Golem.
Yeah, I think a Totem Pass.
Yeah.
You don't want to overload because you want to be playing Fire Elemental the following turn.
Okay.
So you just want to Rockbiter the 3-3, trade the 2-2, and Totem, I think, would be the line I would take. But Feral Spirits, the merits to this play. The 3-3 gets to farm one of the 2-3s, which kind of sucks, but you do protect your 7-7, and you get to hold on to the Rockbiter for potentially spot removal the following turn. You set up better to deal with Ancient War this way, right?
Yeah, and also with like a more token board still, if with the Lightning Storm in hand, you have like other options.
Yeah, because you got to, in Life Coach's mindset there, he's thinking, what possible card does Eloise have in her hand? It's been there since the early game.
It's not a Milt.
She nourished for crystals, which signals that it's some high-cost card. So you can put them on Ancient War, holding the Rockbiter and the Lightning Storm, things like that, so you can set up to deal with the Ancient War better. Makes sense why he went with such line of play, but he's a little bit punished by it for because of the top deck mulch there.
Prophet Valen.
Not a bad one.
I don't know how much synergy it has in this
double
deck.
Prophet Valen Lightning Storm is pretty cool against Token Druid.
Yeah, that's one. But I don't know.
Lightning
is there a Lightning Bolt in the deck, maybe? That's pretty cool. Oh, there has to be a Stormcrack, I think, in one of it, too.
I'm not sure, because Life Coach is playing with the Flame Juggler. I'm pretty sure there is no Stormcrack. Might be one Lightning Bolt around.
Okay, that's fair.
Yeah. I played Stormcrack in a deck before while Life Coach was casting, and he was like, why would you ever play Stormcrack? This card's just terrible. Mm-hmm. When he was casting it. So I don't think he's going to play Stormcrack. He's not a fan of the card.
Yeah, but Life Coach also, just a month ago, was really in disbelief when I told him C'Thun Warrior was like, the best variant of war. This is before Dragon War really came to prominence.
Okay.
And you were just like, nah, there's no way. Temple War is just like too sick. And then we had like a really long discussion. And then he started playing C'Thun War for like 2 weeks on stream and he really loved it.
Yeah, yeah. He's definitely very opinionated, but he's also very open to trying other things as well.
Oh, really? Yeah, it's really interesting.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, it just goes on to this really long
He always takes like a really long time to catch on to the new trend decks, because he takes a really long time to believe they're better, and he really has to try them out for himself all the time, anything that anyone suggests.
But it's really interesting, because Life Coach said that kind of from the start, Dragon Warrior is going to be a thing, and he didn't really find the list, but Dragon Warrior is just one of the better decks, and he was already from the start, he was like kind of experimenting, like, how am I gonna make Druid good? Because with the Fendril and with the new cards, it should be good around.
Yeah, Fendril's insane. Mm-hmm. That card
is. Yeah, imagine if that card was just not on Legendary and just like you could play two of them. Oh my god.
I think we'd see even more Druid than we see now, which would be absurd. Fendril's really good.
Yeah,
I agree.
Easily one of the top five cards in the game right now.
In the game.
In the wall game.
Oh!
Yeah.
Speaking of the devil. Fendril comes into the hand.
Sadly, the ramp from the, like, Fendril with Norish is a really good combo, but now it gets a bit like, I don't need the ramp at 9 mana.
Well, you can cycle Wild Growth.
You get the mana to use this turn, though, which is very nice.
That's true.
Oh.
You just hit a Wrath off this and kill the Totem Golem.
Yeah, Power of the Wilds is also something to do, too. I think the backup was Wild Growth, because the crystals were permanent, so you're able to cycle.
Mm-hmm. So what is the best way to clear the board here? You got Lightning Storm as an option that doesn't seem very good, but you can play a 3-drop with it, which is kind of cute. You have some percent chance of getting the Spell Power Totem, but not great. You got Fire Elemental, which seems okay.
You don't really want to leave this Fendril upright. It's like, so scary always to... Like, you are 4 damage of lethal, so it makes also a lot of sense to take like a more aggressive...
But with one Rockbiter gone, how much damage do you have in your deck? So that the 4 damage.
I see 12 on board with this Doomhammer over sometime.
Yeah, sure.
With the Fire Alley, I don't know.
there's usually only one Ancient of War in Token Druid as far as taunts are concerned. So, you know, set him to 4 in hope, but they hero power and clear your board, and then you're out of luck. But they do have to get through that Fire Elemental, too. Or you could play everything besides the Fire Elemental, if that makes your board a little bit more threatening. You get into some sticky situations against Swipe and other AoEs, though.
I can see Lifeforge leaving up here to Vendrell.
Yeah,
I'm always so scared, but...
Yeah, but if you really
there's one person I know who always likes to just ignore threats who people always overrate. It's Firebat.
Yeah. Like, if this was an Emperor Thorsten...
Emperor can live 6 turns, why not? What's another 6 turns?
It can sometimes when you have enough tempo. Like, the transition from tempo to value is, like, a very important thing to have a good understanding of. And I think Life Coach has a very well understanding of it here, and he's, you know, taking the tempo play and ignoring the potential value of Fandral. Fandral gets kind of scary, though, because it can be tempo and value at the same time with some of the choose ones.
That's a card that makes Fandral still really strong.
Yeah. Yeah, that's...
Like, now you can just consider trading in the Fire Elemental, but also using your hero power together with the Feral Rage.
Yeah.
Yeah, clear the board.
Clear the board.
I like it.
Healing Totem survives.
Like Feral Rage and Refs are the two cards that in this situation will still be really good with Defendral. But besides that, I cannot really get in mind, like, yeah, maybe in Living Roots, but
I support Life Coach's play. I think it's the highest odds play of him winning the game. I think, like his trades into the Fandral were so bad. He loses so much of his board. It's not great. He'd have to, like, maybe take 8 with the Doomhammer to get, like, the full clear there.
Right.
So I think it's just higher odds of him winning the game going for the more aggressive play there.
Wow, Tuskar actually also able to summon the 1-1. It's a long time ago. Yeah, I have seen it off stream or on stream B. There were some ridiculous Tuskars from my side, so it's good to see this refreshing.
How many totem golems did you get from your 4 Tuskars?
4.
The first 5 Tuskars.
The first 5 Tuskars? Summoned, I thought it was only 4.
Yeah, they summoned 5 totem golems, and I felt so bad.
And you're winning the tournament.
4
right?
Rare against Hawk.
Yeah, he blew it all in that one.
After that, it went like a bit downwards. Like after that, I had a mana tide and a flame totem.
So never lucky.
It went a bit downwards.
A mana tide and a flame totem.
Yeah, it went a bit down.
So your 7 Tuskars throughout the tournament have been mana tide, flame tongue totem, and then 5 Tuskars.
No, the first day it was all like nothing. Yesterday it was insane. I felt just sorry, like literally sorry. And
literally sorry.
Yes.
Okay.
Man, do you consider yourself a shaman player?
Well, it seems that I'm like a good Tuskar player at least.
Good Tuskar player.
Yeah.
Tice doesn't like shaman, but he's a big fan of Tuskar.
Eloise might be dead.
Ooh,
one card off. That is brutal.
Bad.
I think is that it?
Can trade the
you only can remove the Tuskar, and you only can go up to 7, which means there's 7 damage on the board. And hey, ignoring Fandral worked out.
That's
some brilliance, and man. A lot of people overreact to Fandral. Mm-hmm.
Myself included.
Well,
when you can set up lethal, setting up lethal is pretty good, especially when you know that their one taunt's gone, and they haven't had AoE removal in their hand for the previous few turns. You've had some kind of soft checks for it.
Yeah.
I'd say it was situations where if Eloise did have the swipe, she could have held it potentially, but there's also a potential it could have been played, so you had sort of some knowledge.
It's a little bit scary, though, because it is the first time, because Druid is Eloise's 5th deck, so this is the first time she's ever played it. So if you guessed wrong with, like, the deck list, like, maybe it's only one taunt. Maybe
I thought she's already been playing it, but
no.
I was just assuming it was,
Tempo
like,
Mage.
The complete standard card-for-card deck.
Right,
Is it a Tempo Mage?
Which is what, in Life Coach's position, you kind of have to assume it's the standard deck.
Why do we still call it a Tempo Mage?
It's a mid-range mage,
when
let's
we
be
call
real.
It
but, I mean, we call it Tempo Mage because...
With Ice Block, Cavalier Stomp.
Yeah, it's the Chinese Mage, right?
It's the same reason we call it a Yogg Druid. It's not really about Yogg at all.
No.
Yeah, a lot of players are cutting Yogg.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Myself included. Wait, what's happened to our screen? Our monitors
shut off.
It's okay. We got these two little backup monitors.
So, Eloise taking the Warrior into the Shaman. How do you think about this matchup as the Dragon Warrior and as the Midrange Shaman?
I think it is one of the best matchups for Dragon Warrior. Dragon Warrior doesn't really have too many polarized matchups, but of the matchups that are kind of polarized, I'd say like it just farms Aggro Shaman so hard. So that's
Midrange
number one, and then matchup number two that it's best in, I'd say, is Midrange Shaman.
Oh, well.
You just get the board so fast, and you're able to push so much damage before they're able to do their late game stuff. Like, they'll be sitting there with Thunderbluff Valiant, and then you just kill them. And even if they play Thunderbluff Valiant, you have great removal for that threat, as well as any of their other threats. And you should most of the time not really lose board too often. So I like it more than I like Zoo against mid-range Shaman. But okay. I think a lot of people prefer Zoo against mid-range Shaman more than they prefer Dragon Warrior against mid-range Shaman. So I'm in the minority there. But I think it's really good.
Okay.
So I'm really happy with the queue order.
Okay, now that makes some sense. Like, I'm just thinking also a bit from, like, I have played a lot of Temple Warrior, and it was also Midrange Shaman. I was like, kind of the matchup I don't want, I felt. Okay. Like, it's not the best one. But I can see, like, Dragon Warrior. Also, Dragon Warrior is just able to deal so well with the truck. Like,
well, with
they play the 1-3 truck, and you play the Alex Travis Champion or the
Or the X, yeah. It's another big factor is, you know, just your sheer amount of removal in Dragon Warrior when it comes to Shaman things. Like, all of your stuff does 3 damage. Most of Shaman's things have 3 health. You got Blackwing Corruptor, you got Alexstrasza's Champion to charge into 2/3s, and it's a 3/3, so it lives and kills something. You got War Axe to kill a bunch of their 3 health minions. So all of your cards just line up so cleanly against everything that Shaman tries to develop onto the board.
Okay, makes sense. Eloise, with the Dragon Warrior, not really getting the dragons here, mainly the spells, and that is going to make the start a little bit on the really slow side for Eloise.
Yeah, that's where you can fall to trouble is when you don't hit that early game curve as Dragon Warrior against any deck, really, because it's a really linear deck. So when you're not hitting those early minions, all the rest of your deck starts getting a little bit worse because they don't heavily rely on you having board, but it is all of your cards are better if you have board, like Frothing Berserker and like all
of that sort of stuff. It's a very snowball-y deck.
Yeah,
I was talking to Eloise, and she just thinks this deck is the best in the game. Like, you know, yesterday when she beat me, we kind of went over some stuff. And she's like, yeah, there's nothing you could have done because Dragon Warrior sweeps your lineup. I'm like, no. Like, I could have just played, like, Druid and had, like, relative. Or even Rogue, which is kind of still better. And she's like, no, it just beats you, like, super easy. And I'm just like, no, it doesn't.
I would prefer to be Rogue against the modern Dragon Warrior builds right
me
now.
Me too. But, I mean, it's just one of those things where she has a lot of faith in this deck. The point is that, you know, she loves this deck. She thinks it's very strong. And she thinks it's, like, by far the best deck. She's not afraid of any matchup whatsoever. Not even C'Thun Warrior, which a lot of players really don't like Dragon Warrior versus C'Thun Warrior.
And I imagine she's going to be able to play it quite well then, with that much confidence.
Yeah.
So.
Well, Frothing here really helping out for the curve now. And Life Coach went for the Tuskar, not really getting a totem he would love to see. Mm-hmm. And now he's like looking, there's no really reason here to go for the Feral Spirits. It just dies on board and you overload. You might consider Hex, but also Rockbiter Hero Power does a great job.
I like Hex. And the reason why I like Hex here is because it saves the Rockbiter for the following turn, where you can play Feral Spirits and Rockbiter if you don't want to be just dropping the 7-7 out. It gives you just more flexibility with your hand, because Rockbiter is way more flexible than Hex is, and you have 2 copies of Hex. Mm-hmm. So that's one of the benefits to Hex. The downside of Hex is Dragon Warrior's got a lot of big crap in their deck. Mm-hmm. So I can also see the argument for Rockbiter as well, just because, you know, 9-9s and Malkorok, sometimes Onyxia, Deathwing, Rag, Grom. So I can see both points of the argument there. And if you're committed to playing 7-7 next turn, I think this plays better.
Do you like that Life Coach went for the more chance on the 1-1 totem? I'm not sure if the 1-1, like he attacked with the 1-1 totem first, and now he gets another one. Don't you want like maybe another totem?
Which totem do you want?
Taunt totem maybe?
Yeah. Taunt totem I guess would be the best, yeah. Yeah, I think Taunt totem's slightly better. See, I can see that point.
1-1's better with Flame Tome.
Yeah. In general, 1-1 totems were always like super weak against Warrior with the Armorsmiths, Ecolize, and with the Ghoul, but only Ghoul is really being played, so it's not too much that the Warrior deals there the way that it really can punish you, besides the Ghoul.
Yeah.
Alexstrasza's Champion, a little bit weaker when it doesn't have the dragon in hand. Not able to deal the 3 damage there.
Also tells a lot about the hand. You didn't have a really good turn 4 play. You played Frothing Berserker off the top. Yep. Now you're playing one without charge. So it's like, there's a lot of information Life Coach has about Elise's hand.
I think that's why he's taking so long on this play, is because seeing how weak Eloise's hand is, you got to be at least a little afraid of that execute.
Yeah.
But he committed to this last turn by using the Rockbiter instead of the Hex. He's kind of in this situation. Now, if he had used the Hex instead, he'd go Feral Spirits Rockbiter here. But, you know, that's all in hindsight, right? You can't just say the play's bad because of the situation, how it came out.
Yeah. No, exactly.
It can also be, like, still a lot of expensive stuff, as we, like, just summed up. There are, like, a lot of expensive minions, I'm always sometimes surprised that, like, it's such an aggressive deck, and then you finally deal, and then they still have all the late game that you're like,
it's Secret
I cannot
Paladin,
even outvalue the deck anymore.
Yeah, it's Secret Paladin. They get you with that. they pretend to be an aggro deck and then they just start dumping 9/9s on you instead of 6/6s with 4 secrets, but it's quite similar.
Yeah. Turns into a 10/9, 9/9.
Same thing. It's a little worse. Still good.
The whole point is that it puts overwhelming pressure from the get-go, and the curve is unrelenting.
Oh, yeah, it doesn't slow down.
And then it also has ways to cement their lead through executes or huge tempo swings. Like, you know, you saw the Blackwing Corruptor, but also the Chargers and everything else associated with it.
Still kind of like that these cards have, like, a spot now in the deck. Like, before...
Ooh, look at this play. Yeah. The biggest tempo play here. I really like this. A lot of players would have went for the slam execute there.
Right, the cleanest kill.
Yeah, the cleanest kill. But then you don't develop anything. You don't get to develop the Frothing Berserker. You're not pushing your board advantage. So I really like this play by Eloise, realizing that my life's not important in the game.
Wow.
But
no, against the Midrange Shaman, it makes a lot of sense.
Take it out of context.
I think it's really good. Recognizing that the life total isn't that significant of a resource and that tempo is more important than the life total there and going for this line.
It's also a mid-range shaman, so it's a lot less threatening.
That's a big factor in that decision. Like, if it's aggro shaman, your life total is very important.
Right.
But against mid-range shaman, they don't really have the bloodlusts or anything like that. And even if they did, they can't really utilize their burst.
What is the best answer for a shaman normally against, like, a frothing, like the 4 HP minions? Like,
Stormcrack?
Yeah, but for life total,
shaman really hates that card. You think
Well, now then you're kind of forced to hex it, maybe, because I don't really want to leave this one up.
No, you can't leave this one up. I mean, you could try to put the stuff in its way. You have two Feral Spirits.
The scariest part about Hex is you got to assume the 6/6 is coming down, right? Eloise's hand has signaled that it's been very weak this whole time, which means either removal spells, which we've seen one of, or,
No dragons.
Or big minions.
No dragon was activated,
No dragon was activated.
She would have to draw with the last two turns.
Sure.
But then also Frothing was played from the right.
Ooh. Okay, then you can assume there's no 6/6. That's correct.
Well, first dragon comes in hand for Eloise now, at least to activate a 4 Blackwing Corruptor.
Awkward.
To the face.
Yeah, I mean, as long as you put it out and get some value.
I mean, I don't like passing or playing in 2/6. Yeah. So.
If you pass, you're just going to get wrecked by Fire Elemental. If you throw out this Blackwing Corruptor, if they do Fire Elemental, Blackwing Corruptor cleans it up quite nicely.
You just saw what Life Coach did in 2 and 4 HP minion, but doesn't hex, and I think you're pretty happy to see that. Really slow approach here against the mid-range shaman.
Yeah, if there's like a Fire Elemental to come down here on this 2-2, you just lose.
Yeah, or even like just a lot of stuff.
Actually, you would slam in Blackwing Corruptor.
Okay, then yeah, that's actually fine.
Yeah.
That's fine against Fire Elemental, but I still don't like it though. I still think it's like a huge surrender of tempo.
I'm personally in the fan of like tempo, because you are very tempo-oriented deck. You are the one that leverages your board.
I can understand the slam Blackwing Corruptor to kill Fire Elemental. If Fire Elemental does come down, you're really happy.
Right.
Then it's a sick play by Eloise. But unfortunately for her, Life Coach doesn't have the Fire Elemental to tempt him to play it on that 2-2.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But anything that he plays from this turn on will get sniped.
Okay.
And one thing that she could be worried about is that Shaman is going to be just playing the resource war, like just keep surviving until she runs out of threats, and then she's just going to get blown out by just the impounding pressure that Shaman's able to play through just toteming up every turn, and then like eventually drawing Thunderbolt Valiant while you're just stuck playing one threat at a turn, if at best.
Hmm. Yeah, there's definitely logic to the play.
Dragon War doesn't have a card draw on the deck, so it's like really hard to finish the game if you don't get an early
lead. 2 slams, 2 Azure Drakes.
That's true.
Some cycle.
I don't hate it. So Blackwing Corruptor definitely wants to come down this turn. I guess you slam as well because you don't want to part ways with your only dragon to activate Twilight Guardian.
Do you want to kill the Mana Tide here, or do you want to kill the Feral?
If we're going for the value play,
Eloise kind of wanted to play the value game after giving up a turn. It really looks like she's more up for the value game than...
I think this line of play that Eloise is taking, the value play, is heavily dictated by the fact that one Hex has been used by Life Coach. Mm-hmm. And we've been talking about that the Dragon Warrior has so many late game threats. Shaman with only 2 Hexes, and now only 1 Hex.
And no BGHs.
And no BGHs. Those late game threats could potentially be the out Eloise is looking for. So she's, instead of taking the traditional approach of Dragon Warrior, which is kill people, she's going to try and outvalue the mid-range shaman, which is, I'd say, a kind of daunting task, because of the decks to try and outvalue, mid-range shaman has to be one of the harder ones.
Yeah, they can just, because Totem Pass is a legitimate threat. Like, you just don't know if they have Thunder Bluff, and you're like, okay, I have to clean up these totems.
Yeah.
It's so scary when you just Totem Pass.
Also, Ragnaros is just not a good card against Shaman. Like, every time they make a totem and you're like, yeah, another bad target for my Rag to hit. And it's
another
just,
0-8.
Yeah, it's like, can be, so Rag, I really, there are two matchups where Rag's just really bad, and Shaman is one of them with Zoo. Mm-hmm. Like, even if you have it and you kill the best target, then Zoo plays three or four minions again, and you're like, yeah, nice, Rag.
Nice.
What are we gonna do here?
Okay. We got, like, Slam Ghoul is, like, the most efficient cleanup option, but that feels awful. So then I'm looking at that
Doesn't
Ragnaros.
Doesn't even clear that well.
Yeah. I think we might have to value trade the 2-3, drop the Ragnaros, and kind of cross your fingers a little bit.
You don't want to play the dragons at all?
The reason why I'm so, like, lenient, so, like,
3-6 doesn't kill anything.
The 3-6 doesn't kill anything on board.
You can slam the 5-3 so it gets challenged by the 3-6.
I guess. That's a valid option as well. But when is Ragnaros going to get better?
Yeah, we're like three targets or, you know.
Two targets out of five. It's a 50-50, yeah. Right? So then I think that's one of the better situations Ragnaros can get in the matchup. And you've seen one hex already, so you're not too afraid of the second hex. And especially since the way Life Coach used the hex in the beginning, yeah, where he like had a decent hex target and then didn't use it and instead like passed his turn with the Rock Biter. So...
Yeah. Oh wow, doesn't take the value trade.
She's afraid of missing. This is like not faith, no faith in the Rag.
It works out good enough, but yeah.
Sure.
Not the optimistic play, the pessimistic play.
Yeah, that's pretty telling of a player, like to show their optimism versus not.
I think it also just depends like in what spot you are.
Yeah.
Like sometimes I do this too when I think my spot is too good, so I don't want to risk anything.
Sure.
But if my spot is bad, I'm like, I guess we have to risk something.
I think that was a spot where you should have risked something.
I think
it's like maybe a bit of nerves and like the stage where you're just like, I don't want to get screwed by RNG. I think the better line is to be a little bit riskier there because you are behind.
Down 0-1. Yeah, and this is like supposedly one of your best decks against the lineup. You're really scared of losing it.
Yeah, it's definitely not an easy situation to be completely impartial to emotion.
One card that is really important for the Shaman that you actually as a don't have to play around normally against Dragon Warrior is the Brawl, right? I mean, are like Dragon Warrior is such a deck that can trade so well with everything during the game, so it makes like almost no sense, I feel, to play a Brawl in the deck.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe there are some, like, it's a good surprise, but... Yeah, do you think it can be any good? Like,
No, you don't want Brawl in the deck. No, there's no way that Eloise is running a teched in Brawl because most of the time you're ahead on board. Unless you're saying at the beginning of the Dragon Warrior build that you're like, I'm going to not fight for board super aggressively and take the value game every time, then Brawl would make sense. It definitely fits the way that she's been playing this game since turn five or...
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But,
So, Life Coach considering to just... play the hand, maybe still totem, but how do you want to trade it also? Because the 6 HP is a little bit annoying. I think if you just want to deal the exact 6 damage, or you can also have the option to trade the totem golem into the 3-3.
Yeah. I think you trade it with the face, though.
Yeah, you're not scared at 28 lives.
Well, a little bit less after we bash our face into this a few times.
Yeah.
But yeah, you're still not afraid, and you need.
Otherwise,
to be...
you fall behind on the value game, maybe.
Yeah, he is falling behind on the value game. He's got an Argent Squire against 3 cards. He doesn't know what those 3 cards could be. One of them could be Deathwing.
Oh, you're right. It could be Deathwing.
And Eloise is actually playing a Deathwing in the
best way to play around Deathwing is to ignore the 3-3 and punch him in the face, and hold back Argent Squire for the reload.
I think he actually plays.
For the reload.
I think he actually plays.
She's
here
holding
around
like
Deathwing.
A literal kitchen knife. Yeah, get out there, Squire. Oh, man.
It's just got to take down a Dragon Lord.
And Life Coach knows there isn't Dragon Warrior in this Warrior deck, so I guess why he didn't went for the Argent Squire, I can only see it being Deathwing.
Yeah, and Eloise might be able to... Like, she got a little unfortunate with the draws here, I'd say, because she took the value line on turn 5, and since then topped deck 2 Fairy Dragons, which are just terrible for the value line. Just absolute... Right. The lowest value card she could have possibly drawn in her entire deck, probably.
Finley is better, right?
Even Finley is better. So it's really unfortunate that she hit both of them when switching to this value line, but even still, she may be able to swing this board back around and run Life Coach out of resources, but that Doomhammer's yeah. really scary.
Also, the double hex seeing being gone, you yes. want to slam like that.
As soon as Grom
big one.
Comes out or Deathwing comes out.
Oh, there's an Argent Squire. You gotta watch out for that.
Yeah.
Just play everything in your hand.
Oh, for sure.
Yeah.
You may be thinking about potentially armoring.
Maybe not playing Warrex is a thing, but.
No, I think you want to play Warrex for sure. You got to kill the minions.
Keeping a dragon in your hand, though, makes the second yeah, Blackwing yeah. Corruptor live.
Yeah,
or
exactly. And you need to be. There's a Doomhammer. You don't want to die.
That's true.
Fair, so. It also, the Doomhammer tries so well into Fairy Dragon.
Yeah, that as well. They would kill it for free, base or for three life, anyway.
Twilight Guard is such an awkward health amount.
Yeah.
Yeah, it is. Like,
you can't,
every
like,
thought is like 3-5
normally. You can't leave it up either because then it gets the value traits too. And then, oh man.
Yeah. The Mana Type Totem was a pretty good pickup for him though still. He's able to reload his hand a little bit.
I actually kind of really like how this game played out. Despite yeah. all, because it took like a much different pivot from what Dragon War usually does. And then yeah. Life Coach is trying to adapt to that. Yeah. And he's still making plays around all these different possibilities.
Also a little bit different for the midrange shaman. Like now I feel the midrange shaman was being the more the aggressive. Or
yeah,
right?
yeah,
normally
yeah.
It's like
the had to switch. Yeah. And it was very important that, like, when Life Coach was like playing the Doomhammer when he didn't right. rushing for damage because yeah. he's on a clock to run out of cards and lose.
Yeah, he drew pretty awkward too. He getting his yeah. squire and his double trogs this late in the game. Like yeah. where's his other stuff? Like fire elementals?
He needs like yeah. Thunder Bluff Valley in here. And
Lightning,
then he would
Storm.
Just win.
Storm would have been great.
Yeah.
Alec here or whatever else he had is like... Something would have been better than just the one drops that don't necessarily do much.
If you look at midrange shaman though, it doesn't really have the most amount of value cards in the world. So
well, I was gonna pick up two cards at least now with this mana title.
Oh.
Ooh,
that's a good one. And that's a good one. And I like how he preserved we were talking about how like he had to switch to this more aggressive mm-hmm. playstyle, and we see him preserving the totem golem there and going face, being the aggressor.
Oh wow.
This is second Rockbiter, right? We got yeah,
second
he used
Rockbiter,
one
yeah.
Rockbiter early game to trade with the Berserker. Yeah.
But,
you know, if Eloise decides to use the War Axe for a value trade,
she's going to die.
She will die.
And
there's
I think
11
it's,
damage.
I think it's correct to use it for yeah. the trade.
I mean, you have some.
Oh,
you've seen
wow.
one Rockbiter already?
Hey, the Argent Squire. What
the
a hero.
I told you, didn't I?
Dude, Eloise is going to be crushed from this.
Yeah, that's really unfortunate.
Wow.
It's kind of anticlimactic.
But even though like Life Coach was able to get the necessary draw to close out this game, you got to mention the fact that he went face with that Totem Golem the turn before, which
yeah,
set up this potential out and
true.
Preserved the Totem Golem. And like
right.
that attack, I don't think a lot of players would necessarily make the double attack into the 3-6
right.
and then trade a 3-3 into it mm-hmm. to preserve a 3-3 that's injured to get healed by healing Totem and go
yeah.
face.
Yeah.
To push the damage to set up for Rockbite to top deck the following turn.
Missing one damage will have lead to him way
would have lost.
Game.
Would have led to him losing the game potentially, yeah. Mm-hmm. So,
yeah. It's yeah. true.
Like, I thought both players played that game really well.
Yeah, that was a very nice mm-hmm. back and forth. And, like, both of them just had to deal with pitiful draws. Like,
yeah,
again,
yeah.
imagine the last card was, like, a charger of some kind to, like, help clean
sure.
up the board. Would have changed up the...
Yeah, those are the most interesting games of Hearthstone when both players draw, like, garbage.
But because, play well.
Yeah, but play well. When they draw very well, it's so obvious what the correct line is, and it's so much easier to play, and one player just snowballs and wins. And when both players draw bad, there's so much more back and forth, and it's more interesting.
So you're in agreement then. We all should just play bad decks.
It's more fun.
Let's just go play Arena for next season's Story Cup.
So no, Arena's too bad of decks, though. There's got to be a happy medium. Because at that point, then it becomes nothing about tempo because none of the decks can kill each other.
It's like all board control.
It's just all value, yeah. And we'd all lose to Crip.
Yeah, none of us want that.
He'd be all smug with his orange juice.
Nah. So, I miss Crypt, man. We should get him back to next season's Story Cup.
So the problem normally against Azul is for the midrange shaman is just not getting anything early game to like challenge it. But this is an end where Life Coach can do has a lot of tools to do something in the early game.
Yeah, you hit three of his four one drops.
Yeah.
Not too bad against an aggro deck. Yeah, we may see a drastically different game from the previous game.
Four squires.
What don't you like more to see here? A squire or an tunnel truck at turn one?
You don't have any buff cards.
I think tunnel truck is a little bit more vulnerable to what things are being played.
Yeah, but you have the
well,
rock
you have the
biter,
rock biter to clean up
the
flame imp, yeah.
Yeah.
So if you play tunnel truck, the biggest weakness you'd see is if they go flame imp, coin, void walker. You saw them kept three cards, so the possibility of that isn't that unlikely, but still I'd say slightly unlikely. Like, you wouldn't consider it a likely outcome.
Is it above or below 50%?
Below 50% in my opinion, for sure. Even with keeping three cards. So I think Tunnel Trug may
just be... It's so much better into Villager and into Squire.
Yeah, so I think Tunnel Trug's the play just because Voidwalker, Coin, Flame Imps, not the likely outcome to happen. But if you feel like your hand is good enough where you can afford to, you know, play around that, then you would go with Argent Squire. And his hand is very good. So I wouldn't hate either play.
If you're Eloise, you kind of put your opponent on having multiple one drops here because of how long it's taking. Well, or is it just standard life cards?
They have so long, and they kept three cards. So yeah, I would assume there's probably a Squire in the hand now after seeing the Trug come out.
We might see four Squires here at turn two, by the way. Just all the Squires on Bart.
I think so.
The light is protecting them.
Someone just rips the most random blood. What was it?
Blood Knight.
Blood Knight out of nowhere makes a 16-16 or whatever it is, 15-15.
Yeah.
And the game's just
If you could get that from Petler or something,
Shifter Zeris into Blood Knight.
Oh, wow.
Shifter
If the shields
Zeris.
Stick around, they just all go face. You Shifter
Jesus
Zeris.
Jesus Christ.
Rip Blood Knight. Win the game.
What a game that would be.
That would be epic. That'd be a number one Reddit post.
Life Coach and Eloise have had some pretty intense games in the past. If you remember ATLC last year, that Zoo versus, was it Zoo versus Zoo?
Zoo against Handlock.
Handlock, yeah, that was crazy. Oh, man, good times. Yeah.
For sure.
So I'm down.
Bring back ATLC. Scamas.
All right. The double Squire is what I was expecting, but Life Coach is kind of hesitating here.
Yeah, I don't see the benefit of making the totem here.
Like the positioning for Flame Tongue?
Yeah. Does anyone else still get triggered whenever you see, like, one minion surrounded by two minions adjacent? Kind of like Dr. Boom's outlay or layout, where it's just like...
It just reminds you of Dr.
Boom? It reminds me of Dr. Boom every time. So now I think it's like Dr. Trug.
I have it on stream, and I call it also like I'm Dr. Trug now.
Yeah.
And you just get frustrated.
Yeah, you just feel like you can't do anything. Yeah.
Well, I imagine Eloise is kind of frustrated. When my mid-range shaman opponent draws three of their four one-drops, I'm not a happy camper.
Yeah, and you know they also have to like good clears, but potential lightning storms.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, Life Coach didn't have much of a play this turn.
No, but
he still has the Rock Fighter.
He's
going to play a 4-mana 7-7 while being ahead on board against Zoo, though.
Yeah.
Like, that's what happens next, and that's insane. Oh, man. So what does Eloise have to do to react to this? Like, if you're expecting a 4-mana 7, I think you just kind of have to hope it's not there.
Yeah.
Well, yeah.
There's a possibility.
I always hope for that.
Yeah, you always hope for that. Oh, dude, Flame Imp's actually pretty sick. Mine. With the Power of Whelming, if it doesn't die, it could trade up. It dies.
Yeah, but normally it will get traded over the Petler.
Hey, you know what can deal with the 7-7?
If you get an Abusive here.
Corruption.
Corruption would be good as well, yeah. Taking that. We don't get to see the choices, unfortunately, but... Like Abusive, Power of Whelming, Corruption are things that you should definitely consider.
Consummon's also a minion that just often if you play it in three and he plays the
7-7, you can kill
him. Normally you can trade it decently away with like maybe a little bit of help from another minion.
Yeah, no Consummon today though. Just two able-bodied minions.
Oh, and there actually is the Corruption for Eloise.
So she's breeding into the 7-7 and getting the Corruption.
She's playing around
She's
the 7-7.
Ready.
She knows, ready.
She
Your opponent
ready.
Hero powered on turn 3.
Yeah. We don't know what the other choices were, but Corruption definitely a pretty sick pickup there.
That's fantastic.
When this kind of stuff happens, you feel like a genius.
Yeah?
I feel like a genius.
Without that Corruption, Eloise was just donezo
here.
She
also gained 7 health with a Voidwalker, too.
Yeah, not too bad. You may play it.
Yeah, I think still think Voidwalker. Wow. I mean, otherwise, it also trades in Petler or goes space for 7.
Oh, man.
Yeah, the other option was Ritual.
Oh, I remember when this, like, back in the day, you only could do this against priests. Like, pick it, and then they had, like, the Death Lords, and then it was so evil.
Summon Doom Guards. Yeah. Like, sick.
Yeah.
It was.
Corruption's, like, almost a playable card now. Like, it's, like, getting really close.
I tried it in my Reno luck.
Reno.
It's, like, really close to being good enough.
But the problem is, like, it still finds often the trait that you don't want to have. It goes on the...
So close, though.
How much do you guys like Imp Gang Boss versus Forbidden Ritual?
I like Imp Gang Boss better. If I'm Eloise right now, I'm shaking in my boots about a storm because those cards have been in Life Coach's hand a little while now.
But sure. Together, like, for two, because you have, like, your turn six with P.O. Doomguard, what I consider as probably a viable option next turn.
So you want to just go both of them?
Yeah, or is, right. Do you what would you
I
like
I can get
to
behind
tap?
Both of them, yeah. I tapping with a Doomguard in hand is kind
I'm not
of
a good zoo player, so I would prefer asking you.
Okay. With the Doomguard, if you were playing, like, a non-Doomguard variant, tapping's a lot better.
Mm-hmm. Oh, wow.
No fear of the storm, taking the risk.
And hey, you were saying that she was playing scared a
yeah,
lot
throughout the series.
Throughout the earlier games, I think she was playing a bit scared. And
sometimes you got to switch things up.
Sometimes you switch it up a little bit.
Not always, though. You can't always just play risky because then you're, it's bound to
yeah,
bite
it's bound
you.
To bite you. You have to figure out when is the time to make the risk, which is based on reads of your opponent's hands. Maybe Life Coach has been touching his cards, signaling things. Maybe she...
Or not touching it.
Or not touching it.
It's not playable mana-wise.
Yeah, I know. Whatever mind games you want to play there, but yeah.
It's true.
Yeah.
Vera, normally really don't like the Feral Spirits. Now I kind of lean towards it because it gives you the option to trade with the 2-2. And within all the 2-3s, it feels pretty decent. Or what you love to see, like a 5-5 that potentially dies to Gorm or PO like so easily.
I agree with you. I think the Feral Spirits are very nice. You take the value trade on the 2-2, and then your minions aren't vulnerable to the common thing that comes after Forbidden Ritual, which is Direwolf Alpha, trade up your entire board. So having those 2-3s is actually such a clutch health total against
them. Also, the truck gets buffed in a nice way.
And Things from Below just dies to Power of Warming, like you said, which is incredibly weak. So yeah,
pretty
good call.
Strange that this, like, overloading yourself. Oh, wow, that's really aggressive.
Well, he does have the two of the best tempo cards in the entire deck.
True.
So I guess he's trying to...
Like, I'm a bit scared of Argus. That's what I was thinking of, because Argus is a little bit nasty, you know?
Yeah, Argus blows you out here. So I like tap Argus here from Eloise.
Oh.
I don't think you really want to use Power Overwhelming, but... I mean, you know there's no Storm, so you could try and, like, take this initiative and just kind of close out the game with it.
If there was a hand, like, with Storm, I can get behind it.
That's... Power Overwhelming clears the board, though.
Yeah, but at what cost?
At the cost of a Power Woman. And a card.
Wow.
I mean, the potential cost of, like, it makes it more awkward to deal with some of the bigger threats that could come out. A card's more than a card, Froden. It's also an answer.
That's deep. Whoa.
Ooh, oh, man. Hey, it's too much overload to play them together.
Awkward, though.
Just the shaman
things are starting to be as a shaman.
Let's just what if you totem pass? I think that's the play. Next turn, you're going to go totem, things from below, storm.
Ooh. And what with this draw? Like,
I think you just.
But now it is either in 2-1 or the Argus is gone.
Right.
Yeah, I don't know. It wouldn't work out great to totem pass because Eloise, none of her plays play into storm. But if her hand did play into storm, it'd be crazy.
Yeah. Juggler and another peddler, abusives.
So it's based on Life Coach's read now.
I would always slam the lightning storm here. Okay. I think it's too good.
Yeah, you think it's too good, or you read that Eloise has no more cards to play into it? Because the Doomguard might be a safe assumption at this point in the game. Based on especially the Forbidden Ritual turn, leans towards a potential Doomguard.
He also saw already one Forbidden Ritual. Like, what are the minions that's gonna...
And Life Coach agrees with you. I think it... I would have thought it... I would have liked the fancy play, but it would have been wrong.
Wow, three on everything.
The read there from Life Coach was really good in anticipating things that don't play into Lightning Storm. My
seal for Argus. And Life Coach is holding these cards
it's
for such a long time.
It's actually pretty big that the 2-1 gets killed. Otherwise, the Argus had another target and makes the value turret into the 1-1.
Yeah.
Well, I think we're gonna see here some things for zero.
Yeah. Things for free.
Yeah. Just zero mana 5/5s.
Good card.
Nothing to...
Not broken at all.
Nah. The
balance team was spot on with that one.
I mean...
I love it, Tyson.
I don't mind it for this deck, kind of, because Midrange Shaman has, like, some problems being available, but
you
this
can
card
play
for Aggro
in
Shaman
every
feels
every Shaman variant.
Yeah.
You play it in Bog Creeper Shaman.
Yeah.
Aggro Shaman, Midrange Shaman.
You could put it in Bog Creeper Shaman. I don't know if it's amazing, but it's pretty good.
This card's not really giving, surprisingly, options for Life Coach until now, but... At least still a totem. I mean, it's just a good card already. Two mana, 3/2 with a 1 mana hero power. That's how I sometimes see the card at worst.
This looks like a disaster.
Oh. Well,
look. Was it Twisting Nether?
I mean, Doomguard is at least some way to fight back on the board.
Yeah,
here.
Second Imgang Blast is pretty nice.
Yeah, and you kill both the 5/5s. You leave behind a 1/1 token in your steed.
And you hope Life Coach top decks, you know, Tunnel Trog. That's his only one drop left, right? That's what makes the opening from Life Coach so scary. Is not only was it really good at the time, but now it helps him so much better because his percent chance to find good big cards is increased quite a bit.
Wow.
That's how good is that? Yeah, you clear the board.
And you have a healing totem, too. Dang. I don't know, man. It's a really hard position from Zoo to come back from when they can get a full board like this.
Yeah.
And you're not able to really get the value anymore.
Yeah, so you got to put it between, like, the 3-2 and the 0-2 and trade. See, otherwise you can't clear the Imp Gang boss efficiently, right? And then you kill the Imp Gang boss and then trade the Spell Power Totem into the Doom Guard and then trade the 1-1 Totem into an Imp and then the Healing Totem into the other Imp. And you've cleared the entire board. You're left with a Healing Totem, a Flame Tongue Totem, and a Taunt Totem.
Wow. Wow.
What?
That's pretty clean.
Yeah, yeah, it's nice. It's very smooth.
Yeah.
Or you can be more aggressive and push some damage face and ignore the Imp Gang boss, but my personal favorite line is killing it.
Yeah, you cannot really, like... I mean, like, the 0-2, the Spell Power Totem doesn't die. Yeah, you have to just throw it in there, then.
Looks like we are ignoring Imp Gang boss. Huh.
I don't like this
I don't
this
like
too
this
much.
At all.
No.
No, I think that was the third
that
best line
weird.
There. Yeah.
And...
He only had one card to play that turn.
It feels like all of a sudden there is a window to come back now.
There's a chance.
Knife Juggler also. Oh, can do and can
Juggler do has a minion. For, like the
yeah,
3-2.
But it has to hit twice the same one. So it's going to be
too bad
hard.
That never happens, right, Tice?
Well.
Juggler snipes one board in the midst of a few others on the board.
Yeah, I think you Juggler and then you trade into the Taunt Totem. Hope it hits the Tuskar and then play your Councilman. Your Councilman is then only...
A 2-5.
Yeah.
Yeah, you can also play it first to make...
One
five. I think you have to make it a 2-5 maybe because of all the 2 HP minions.
Yeah, you may be right. You may be right.
So maybe we just hope the first Juggle doesn't hit the Taunt Totem.
Yeah, yeah, I'm on board with that. I think you're right.
I mean, still pretty unlikely, all things considered.
Ooh.
Ooh, okay. Well.
Yeah, maybe this one will go face too.
Yeah.
Well.
That's...
Still a Dark Shark Councilman on the board.
Ooh, Hex isn't bad here. Being able to Hex the Imp Gang boss...
It's also not too great, I would say.
Yeah, it's kind of mediocre.
Like, yeah, you find the trait, but still a really hard challenge that we are fighting for board here.
Well... You're looking down an 0-1 and a 1-1.
Yeah, the 2-2 has to... The 2-1 will trade into the...
Juggler's also really threatening.
Yeah, you kill the Juggler, and then you kill the...
You kill the Hex.
The Dark Shire, and you Hex
and
the
Imp.
You can also Hex the... Nah. Hex Councilman here. Five face.
Then you just... Okay. Okay. Aggressive.
Cutting down the life
taps. We are sometimes aggressive.
Cutting down the life taps.
We are getting more aggressive.
So that way, if he picks up Doomhammer or
Fire
Elemental.
If he picks up Doomhammer, he is going to win, yeah.
I mean, he's setting up his outs. I mean, I kind of like that attack. That's the one that's hard to spot.
Yeah.
You're like, I really want to not die.
I'm a fan of it. I'm a fan of it.
Well, we have to tap here, right? Yes. Okay, another
one. That's a pretty good draw.
Oh, man, this may punish Life Coach very heavily.
So, what do you like to abuse if the...
Abusive the 1-1?
Yeah, you're going to abusive the 1-1. You go Knife Juggler, and then...
Abusive the 1-1, you kill the Flame Tongue, assuming it doesn't...
Well,
and then you have
you
the
take
two
the trade into the Tuskar before you abusive, right?
You can also trade the 2-2 into the 1-1.
Oh, okay. That's also fair. I like that,
to get,
too.
Like, extra Imp Gang boss value. I think Eloise really needs, with this life total and all the boards that
is... Just maximize the
maximize
the
Imp Gang boss value. I can see that as well. And you get plenty of juggles to kill the Tuskar. Yeah, I like that.
I mean, the first one is going to be, like, deciding, maybe. Because if it hits, like, the 1-1, then...
Yeah. You got a taunt to protect it, which also is pretty good for that line. So I like it. I think that's the better play. Abusive the 1-1, kill the Flame Tongue Totem, then take the value trade with the Imp Gang boss. Oh.
Oh, and it really makes the value trade even better with this 50-50 left now.
Oh.
Okay. Well, this, the Frog also doing work
That's
now.
That's a good card.
That's a pretty good one.
That's one of the ones that can take it home. Mm-hmm. At least buys you a lot of time, right?
Yeah, I mean, it's going to be dead on
board. It has to get traded away. Yeah.
Oh, sorry. Unless Taunt Totem came, it was... Then it'd be pretty good.
Whoa! Okay.
There we go.
Yes, Zoo can also play strong cards. You can play 4 mana 7
Oh, my God.
Well...
I think it's playable no matter what. If you shoot,
yeah,
you play Gormok on a 3/6
Then you have a 3 mana Sea Giant.
Yeah, at worst.
Oh, no, the Gormok will also find the play, yeah.
Leaving this Imp Gang boss up kind of hurt a little bit.
Yeah. By a little, I think you mean a lot.
Yeah. We could have killed that a few turns back.
Oh, like, man.
That and its whole family could have died.
The totem family.
Yeah.
Oh, we don't... I don't know how much, like, if you want this knife from the Imp Gang boss badly.
Insurance. I mean...
I still feel about it be, like, get all the value I can.
Yeah. I think you do. Well, is there any way to, like, set up lethal, too?
I think this is the
That's the most damage, right?
Yeah. So, 8, 10,
this
17.
This one knife, this trade called happened first, and then you had the extra knife on the minion.
Ooh, Doom Hammer!
So
He's
Doom
dead.
Doom Hammer.
Well, no, Eloise has one card off the top, and the jungle has to go face.
Right.
Yeah.
That's what you
so
do,
you
right?
So 50-50
well,
for lethal.
The Taunt Totem is also... If there's a Taunt Totem...
If there's a Taunt Totem... Life Coach is able to win unless Eloise top decks something. So now it's a 50-50 for lethal.
Oh, nah, but they're also like just buff cards that
forbidden
are just...
Forbidden Ritual, buff cards. So at worst, 50-50 for lethal.
It's gonna be
there's
like
also a Forbidden
I
Ritual.
I bet it's going to be a Flame Imp.
You can also...
No.
Can you tie?
Is there two of Flame Imps left or just... There's one, right?
There's one.
One.
Can you tie if that's the case? If the Joker goes face and Flame Imp hits you?
The battle cry happens before the minions played. So I think you would lose.
Yeah. That's how it works. Forbidden Ritual is guaranteed lethal, by the way, because you can trade the 1-1 in.
Yeah, so that's Forbidden Ritual is guaranteed lethal. I think there's one Abusive Sergeant. Dark Peddler is guaranteed lethal, right?
Oh!
Yeah.
Because you trade first, play Peddler, and then play the 1-drop-off Peddler. And then there's...
No more Argus.
No more Argus. Direwolf Alphas?
Yeah,
you
Direwolf
haven't seen
Alphas.
Either. There's two Direwolf Alphas.
Also, still haven't seen much 1-drops. Like,
Guard.
Villagers are, like, still in the deck.
Villagers are bad, yeah. There's, like...
It's more than half of her deck remaining.
Yeah, there's at least there's six outs at least.
Oh,
That's not it. So it's 50-50.
Oh my god.
Yeah, there's nothing you can increase it. Nothing. Voidwalker was like also still like.
Yeah, Voidwalker installed it.
Yeah,
we have seen one, but.
Oh man! For the 3-0 lead.
I just attacked face with everything first, and then the jiggle decided. Wow.
That's justice.
Yeah,
that's
like the last very in Eloise's favor.
Yeah, yeah.
You have to be honest, half her deck was directly out, and if
more
that was
that,
so it was like 75% for Eloise, kind of.
I think she played that game very well.
Yeah.
Like, with Life Coach's hand and his start and the way the game progressed, I think...
I thought Shaman was going to blow it out.
Yeah, I think Life Coach...
7-7 off of the 2-3 1-drops.
But Zoo has a good hero power. Like, they can draw cards where the Shaman then sometimes gets in the late game and just doesn't get it going.
Yeah, I think with Life Coach's hand, though, he should have won that game. The way it played out.
Yeah, he went aggressive, and it's really, like, it came close.
Was it the Lightning Storm
really...
play, you think, if you went for the
Lightning
Storm?
The Flame Totem.
The Flame Totem. He should have killed that in-game
boss 100%. You're right.
There's
no way
that it was correct to ignore it. He pushed, like, what, 2 extra damage to leave up a 2-4?
Well, he put himself... Yeah, I guess right. The only thing they did was put himself in a position to win through 50-50 on the juggle. By the consequence, because he went for that face damage.
Well, the face damage turn was when he did the hex, which I thought was fine. Right. I just think that the first Flame Tongue Totem turn, where he could have cleared Eloise's board completely, leaving him with 2 totems and a Flame Tongue Totem, and being able to react to pretty much any minion she plays with that board, I think if he just does that and clears her board completely, he's going to win. Imp Gang boss is just such a threat because it generates so much value.
Yeah, there were more clean ways to do it for sure. And, I really like how the game is now going. Like, we have first seen the Dragon Warrior against the Shaman. That's totally a different approach than it normally goes. This one really going to the value game. Like, Eloise really playing the value decks here, like, with the Dragon Warrior. And now it was, like, close, but now it really paid off. And, from Life Coach, I think we're going to see the Rogue here because maybe that's, like, I'm not sure how that will fit against some value mage deck.
Okay.
I kind of,
Yeah, the Rogue comes out. Rogue, he also has Dark Iron Skulker in the Rogue, right? Yeah. Which is a great card against
and,
a lot of times.
Argent Squire.
Argent Squire, yeah. Which is great when you draw it turn one. Terrible when you draw it in the later stages of the game off your Gadgetzon and it's not a spell and you cry. But yeah,
very fortunate sequencing too for the decks, because Eloise had the coin last game, so Life Coach kind of knew that there's a high chance of him getting the coin this game, and having Rogue on the matchup just improves the matchup against Zoo a lot more, because I know a lot of people feel like Rogue is fair against Zoo, but the more I play, I feel like Zoo actually has like a very reasonable chance against.
So, do you believe that the coin more often flips between the two players rather than just being a true 50-50?
I think so. You want to take notes?
I think so as well. It's something I've observed in practice.
Yeah.
So, I often cue the order of my decks depending on the coin. Oftentimes,
I think I made that mistake
yesterday
because I forgot about that. I was playing the series and I played Rogue when I was off. When I was on the play and on the coin.
Yeah, because I've played a lot of Hearthstone, and I've never had a time where I've had the coin more than five times in a row, ever.
In practice
In practice games. Yeah, I've never had the coin more than five times in a row, which is like statistically ridiculous for the amount of practice.
I had the European Championship that I had four times in a row, like at the
four
final.
That,
like I was really, oh no, I had the coin already three times in a row, and then it was the Rogue Mirror at the end, and I was like, no, but there was the coin.
I don't think it's guaranteed, I just think it's likely.
Yeah, I don't think it's guaranteed. It just seems like it weights it a little bit or something.
It would be nice if we could kind of choose in a sense. Like we would understand like consistently how that would happen.
I don't know. It may just be a true 50-50 and we might be just nuts. We might have to take off our tinfoil hats and stop being crazy, but...
Well, yeah. There's definitely some like coin flipping math theorems that are out there that, like, because it's 50-50 and just the odds of like more than five coming out, it's actually pretty high if you put it across of tens of thousands of samples, right?
What?
Like, basically,
if it's 50-50 time one and it's 50-50 time two, isn't it safe to say it's going to be 50-50 time three?
Yeah, but then you're saying over the course of, like, tens of thousands of samples.
But they're independent events. They don't influence each other.
Yeah, but over the course of 10,000 samples, what's the likelihood of having, like, five or six of them
happen
in a row?
You're saying the likelihood to test to see if it's true,
right,
50-50 or not.
Or to even support your claim that you never got it more than five times.
Yeah, I did a small sample test of that to try and... And I think it does weight it a little bit one way or the other when you've had the coin multiple times.
Titus is uncomfortable. We're talking about really stupid math stuff here. So Life Coach...
I was just looking at the game a little, like... No, but I totally
agree.
I mean,
it's kind of relevant.
I totally agree.
Like, you agree that it's a game about
numbers.
Flips a lot of the time.
I have the feeling that it flips way more often.
Yeah,
than
it should.
I don't feel like you, that it is like so, that it like always, but it way more often it flips around.
Yeah, 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 but then it should.
I agree.
It's way more than 50-50.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But yeah.
Competitive game.
Yeah, well, it's important for like decks like Rogue.
Yeah.
It can be a big influence.
You have to abuse those things if they do exist.
Also,
and they said Q order didn't matter in Conquest.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
It does to a certain degree.
For coin math.
Yep. I mean, every edge matters. It's a numbers game, man, especially in card games.
Ooh, Imgen Ball is really good at turn three. Like, Eloise picked up the Mortal Coil from the... Oh, you really want the Mortal Coil? I will just land the Imgen Ball. It's like, it can abuse the Squire so much.
Yeah. Maybe she's afraid the Quail will never find a target if she doesn't use it. Imgang Boss, though, is a lot harder to play with other cards the following turn.
It's also maybe you're so great at turn three.
Well, if you're expecting Coin into
Pillager
or Violet Teacher,
right?
You do not want to power your Imgang Boss. That's real bad. So having the 2/2 in play to be able to power that and then play the Imgang Boss is quite good. So maybe that's what she's anticipating, and... That could work out quite nicely for her.
Yeah, coin 4 drop is actually one of the most threatening things Zoo faces in the early game, outside of a coin SI7 with backup.
But now she's not even mortal calling. Oh yeah, well, you buff your minion, so it gets a bit less scary. Cold Blood Answer, but not sure if it is the best answer. Fan of Knives also doing a good job here, and with the Skulker in hand, like, the problem we had in practice a lot in this matchup, because we really wanted to be too badly.
You play Fan, and then they Forbidden Ritual,
you
and you
play your Fan, and you just, like, you have to keep it on with your Fan too much.
Yeah.
Like, often it's fine, but it can be just so great, and that's why I was even trying a Pyromancer, but it's so bad because it always kills himself.
Yeah.
So, and then there was, the Skulker actually just skulks them all out of the game.
Just skulks.
That's what he is. That's what he does.
Yeah, I like the fan here. I think fan's a solid play. Just because of the Skulker in hand, you don't have to worry about the Forbidden Ritual. No reason to hold on to it. And it gets a decent amount of value on the board, better than your other options. You get to save the coin. I don't think you want a Cold Blood trade or anything.
I mean,
crazy.
Cold Blood is a hard card to find value against Sue. I mean, Telnos Cold Blood is not a bad play here.
Yeah.
Cold Blood is a clunky card against Sue. I did it on my Argent Squire, like, also in a game, then it was like...
Is Life Coach running Conceals?
Yeah.
Yeah. Cold Blood Conceal kills a lot of Zoo. Unless they have, like, you know, their few taunts, and even their taunts are small enough that you can then plow through them, but... Sure.
So, what is better than an M-Gang boss than 2-5 now? Wow. That's a really hard M-Gang boss to kill.
And it might even get buffed again.
Yeah, but it's really... In this matchup, it's really key, because there are quite some minions that have, like, 4 attack. Like the Azerdrake. Like the... Well, the Skulker will not be seen play here, but...
Yeah. Skulker, not exactly the most amazing value here.
Blood Imp coming in huge. I wonder what her other choices were on the Blood Imp selection.
I know, this little Discover bug's quite unfortunate for Spectator Moon.
Yeah.
Drake's still the best answer. Picks up Prep. Prep could change it.
Easy Prep, clear the board. Mm. Ah, Sap's
but
good for the following.
You see how big the buff here is, because now the Abusive Surgeon is just doing an amazing job. Mm-hmm. And there in second Imgang walls, things can go really... like, Rogue just doesn't...
Okay, I like it.
Okay.
I like it way better than the Abusive. The Imp Gang boss is... I mean, not the Imp Gang. The Blood Imp has done its job and got in there.
Yeah.
Pretty solid.
Forbidden and, Ritual. And, yeah, the insurance against Dark Iron Skulker with the 2-6 now. Wow!
Oh, it buffed it. Wow.
With his last dying breath.
That's a good blood.
That's actually pretty big, because now in Fan of Nice of his or something won't kill it. Maybe you just gonna consider sapping it, because it gets super annoying at the moment.
Yeah, sap fan seems pretty solid. When you see a Forbidden Ritual come out from Zoo kind of hastily like that, you always gotta imagine Doomguard. We saw it in the previous time when Eloise Forbidden Ritualed, and when most people that are playing Zoo Forbidden Ritual, they have a Doomguard in their hand. That's usually the pressure that makes them play that card.
Yeah, I agree. This is how else are you supposed to get the value if you... Yeah, don't play for individual first.
Yeah, so I really like the sap man.
That can be really working out well. Gadgets are normally a really slow card against the Zoo, but here with the prep now together, double Imgang boss getting back on the board.
Not too bad. And time to find prep number 2.
6 second prep.
I think it's a gadget.
Yeah, there has to come a gadget in here.
Yeah.
Or, actually, it's just a second prep.
Oh.
Max has a little awkward, but...
Not sure. Like, with a second one, you might just keep on it.
I think you hold on to it. You have a second gadget as well.
You can just kill the 1-1 with your dagger.
Yeah.
Dagger can be just so amazing. Like, you can play it once, and then it always sticks there, and you use it whenever it finds some value.
Either backstab or daggering, the 1-1 has to happen, though. You have to kill that 1-1, otherwise you run the risk of Power Overwhelming being live to kill your gadgets in Auctioneer. And then it gets super awkward. Life Coach wants to preserve the dagger. Why do you think he wants to preserve the dagger here?
Because he doesn't want to re-dagger next
maybe
turn.
Maybe he just wants the card. I don't think it's about the dagger. I think he might just instantly wants the card with the specs then.
And we see that Power of Overwhelming. So it's really important that he kills the 1-1. It doesn't really matter how. That's like the minor detail to the play there. The most important thing is make sure that 1-1's dead so you don't get blown out by Power of Overwhelming.
Doomguard feels so strange here with the... Like, you can play Abusive and Power and almost make no discards, but it's just not doing much. Like, you kill... Like, you still need to trade this, so...
Yeah, you only do 13 damage if you go all phase.
Yeah, and ignore the gadgets then.
Yeah.
Risky idea.
Do you tap?
Yeah, I was also like, I don't like the Doomguard.
Yeah, the other lines are so
26
bad.
26 lives still.
Oh.
What are you trying to even look for when you tap, though?
Yeah, that's what I'm trying to think about.
Argus?
Soulfire?
I like Argus.
Oh, Argus would be good.
Argus is good.
But I don't know if I'd be willing to tap just for that one.
Powerwhelming, Abusive face, Doomguard face?
I think you trade.
Yeah.
You cannot ignore this. The Power Overwhelming is just played for the show here. I mean, it doesn't matter.
Yeah.
Just feels better to discard one than discard two.
Even though you really are discarding two.
Yeah.
Just spend a lot on
the
game
boss. I made it.
All right.
Well, Shadow Strike SI. cleans the 5-7.
That
we can also do Skulker.
Skulker Eviscerate.
Skulker Eviscerate is a full board clear too.
But then actually, you have to take better. 5 damage.
I'm not sure if I like this Skulker. Like, it can be like so good.
It's better
still.
Later
it's
on,
like,
right?
It's so good in this matchup, and this is just okay what you do with the Skulker.
Yeah, I like Shadowstrike SI better. I think that's the play I would go for. You Shadowstrike the Doomguard, SI the Doomguard, then Dagger Poke the 2-1.
Normally the Consulman is like the Shadow Strike target, but if you are on board at an SI, you can normally trade also decently into it. It doesn't grow directly to an insane amount.
Yeah, you got Eviscerate for Consulman too, so should be okay.
All right, so Ellie's just going to need to pick up some bombs here, but she's already discarded her Sea Giant.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Direwolf, not really. Well, I mean...
It could clear.
It is a potential clear.
And then you're met with Skulker.
Whoa. Yeah,
there you go.
Every little bit that matters.
And now you just hope there's no Dark Iron Skulker.
I mean... do we spill a Skulker?
Yeah. Yeah, I think we do.
Skulker
dagger up
though.
Into gadgets.
I mean, you can also Ezra Drake, deadly poison.
Well, we want to save the deadly to cycle with the gadgets. And
yeah,
you
that's
get the Skulker,
true.
Develop the dagger, set up for a great gadgets in turn the following turn.
Yeah,
I don't see how you lose if
yeah,
you just
like a
dagger.
Forbidden Ritual can be a bit rough. That's why I like. If there's one card that there's a comeback now for Zoo, the only card I feel is Forbidden Ritual. But
all right, I can understand that.
It's.
I think you still beat Forbidden Ritual. We did use a Cold Blood
earlier,
though.
I think so, too.
We have less damage, but I don't know. It just seems so good.
Just knowing Life Coach also a little bit, I know he's really highly considering this as a break.
Yeah, to play around the Forbidden Ritual. Okay.
You already used both backstabs, right? So Drake couldn't even pick up.
Ooh, wow. Goes for the best deals.
The best deals.
Not sure if these are the best deals. Huh. Like just throwing one card.
I wasn't expecting that play at
all.
No, I don't understand that one.
Ezra Drake poison.
Too stupid to get this.
Ezra Drake poison has to be better.
And it works out.
I mean, what if he just kills your Gadgetzin and you start fizzling out of cards, or what if they have like?
I mean, Ezra Drake did exactly the same.
Yeah, Ezra Drake did the same amount of card draw, and you still have a Gadgetzin.
You can like top deck like on prep or on the backstab, and then it gets like
you
a little.
One
better.
Prep, one backstab. It's not anywhere near in your favor.
No, I don't think so. I don't think so either.
Yeah, I would have liked the Drake a lot better if we were going for the safe line.
Eloise thinking about maybe not even playing Knife Juggler?
Or playing which order? Like, do I want to buff the Consulman or do I want the Knife, I think?
Could be one of those things where it's like,
do I hold it for Forbidden
Ritual as my only comeback potential?
So I think we're going to see a fast Coach play here.
Can he Life find was lethal? He's used how many Eviscerates in Cold Bloods?
We saw
two Eviscerates, one Cold Blood,
so there's no lethal.
So, yeah. Gonna start off with the Deadly Poison, I would say. Yeah.
Dark Iron Skulker and Deadly Poison is a clear.
Yes, also prep still being like, might give you some options.
Zap would be sick.
Well, I mean, it's a spell.
Wow.
There and you go. That's something.
I think you clear the board and conceal.
GG.
Yeah, what works? This works.
The Rogue is so sick, man.
Yeah.
People are making fun of me so much. Because I was like, I thought Rogue was good, and you're doing well with it.
I think
Life Coach is doing well with it.
8-3 with Rogue now, and it takes like all the matchups I don't want sometimes.
Condition, of course, that you have to be playing at a competent level with it.
But, mm-hmm.
That's going to wrap it up here. And Life Coach is one game away. Well, Life Coach thought the series is over.
No, might be just small.
Life Coach, it's the best of 7.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Never mind. Okay. Just going to the bathroom.
So series are sometimes long. Life Coach also not being the fastest players. Best of 7s can take some time. And we are also humans. We got to take our toilet breaks.
Well, I don't know. Me and Froden met in the bathroom before the series. We were both taking our bathroom break. We knew we were casting a Life Coach series.
But he went before, too.
Oh, okay.
He's also
I'm really glad you clarified why we went to the bathroom, because you just kind of shared.
Oh, yeah, we were just hanging out.
Nothing.
No, like every time before a Life Coach series, as a caster, you have to prepare yourself.
Mm-hmm.
You got to, you know, get the banana in, do the Stancifka approach, get the fruits and vegetables going on, and then take the bathroom break so you're ready to go.
Carve your name into the wall, fire bat, and throw it in was here.
Yeah. That makes sense.
Same stall. Why is it over the middle of the stall, not between them? Hmm. Weird. All right.
Okay.
Don't want to know.
Yeah, life coach, he's up 3-1. And that puts Eloise down to her last deck. I believe it is the tempo mage.
Yeah.
The tempo mage.
It's the, at least.
I mean, if we're calling it tempo mage, you shouldn't call it tempo warrior. You shouldn't call it Yogg Druid. You shouldn't call it a lot of stuff.
When I was in China casting EU versus CN, everyone kept telling me the Chinese tempo mage was the tier one best deck in China.
Yep.
So I don't know if they're still on that train of thought.
I mean,
they are. They still think it's the most dominant lineup.
Just the best deck in the entire game. So, who knows?
I mean, some people have the philosophy that Druid right now might even be the best deck in the game because it just has no bad matchups.
I think Druid is very strong. I think it could definitely be
the best.
It's
tier one.
I mean, it's tier one for sure.
But is it the best deck in the
game? It also has no goodness.
Is it outclassed every warrior deck?
The problem is
every shaman deck.
If you say, like, I think warrior is definitely the best class in the game. Like, sure. I don't think anyone can argue with that. There's like five tier one warrior decks. So I think
a couple tier one or tier two,
you know, So I think warrior is the best class in the game, but druid could definitely be the best deck in the game because historically throughout the past in Hearthstone, the deck that's always been the most dominant and oppressive deck isn't the deck that has, you know, the best matchups overall versus the expected field. It's the deck that has the least bad matchups all around is always the most oppressive and overpowered deck, which is what druid was in the past.
Yeah, just, not to mention it might not even have the highest win rate either because it's so meta-defying that people counter it so heavily.
Yeah, so...
Like Patron.
When it's a deck that you cannot counter, that's what kind of makes it OP because people just feel like, it doesn't matter what I do, I have like, you know, 55% chance to lose or whatever, and that feels bad.
Fair enough.
I think this actually is a pretty nice to great matchup for the mage. I think this is one of the matchups you want. You have like the Forbidden or the Forgotten Torches to trade a bit. You have your some time because Rogue is super reactive, so your spells are finding better use.
It's also not bad against the Hunter. If Life Coach is bringing similar Hunter to what you brought, which is the Camel Hunter, then it brings out a Mana Worms. Like, well, that's really bad. And then the last class Life Coach has is
I think he has Druid. I think Druid should be pretty decent against it.
Yeah, it's pretty even, I think.
It's possible for the Tempo Mage to win for sure.
It's just hard because it's Life Coach.
Yeah.
It's hard because you're down, you have to win three in a row.
Yeah.
And Eloise on the coin, by the way. Theory is still
confirmed. Sample size of one. We're doing it.
Let's keep track from this point
on. This matchup is really good, guys. I have one today.
We don't really need to keep track. We just let Twitch chat keep track.
Yeah. I mean, I feel kind of bad for people. This is kind of like tools of the trade to some of the top players.
Yeah, I'm kind of sad you mentioned that because that was something I was like holding on to.
Yeah, I do it already for a year, I think.
Like, yeah,
really long.
I'm sorry, dude. I shouldn't have released that to the public.
Now all of the semi-pros are going to start coming up and taking our spot, man.
Yeah. Every little
I'll probably still at that fire, but it gets harder and harder.
To be fair, someone else was going to mention it eventually. The jig's up.
The jig's up.
Yeah. Good save, Froden.
Good save.
Saved.
Nah, it's probably just not even real. Like, people on Reddit will figure it out, and they're going to be like,
don't believe Froden. Don't do a Monty Python.
Like,
And now you have, like, people that are going to test friendly matches to, like, 100 times conceding and see what's going on.
Yeah, that's what we did.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
You did it? Oh, I know.
A lot more than 100 times.
Oh.
It took a really long time. It was crazy boring.
Yeah. But this is, like, the kind of stuff that people are, like, not paying attention to. And they just, like, dismiss Hearthstone as just, like, this thing that, I mean, just do whatever. You can't get an edge. You're just so 50-50.
You can get an edge
in
everything.
It's like, that person is just dumb.
Yeah, like,
can we just talk about how unintelligent that person is?
I've played video games a really long time, and there's always a way to get an edge. Yeah. Like, there's always little glitches you find, little system things. You figure out the patterns.
Yeah.
Like, that's what playing video games at a competitive level is figuring out every little edge and just...
Super monotonous, you know, training sessions. You just practice the same stupid small
and
thing
then,
over
like,
and over. Just watch, like, a Dota pro practice. Like, they're mid... stuff. It's just, like, insane.
Eventually, everything just becomes muscle memory, and you memorize, like, without even, like, knowing actually what the patterns are, you start identifying them and seeing them.
Yeah.
All right,
well, the Sorcerer's Apprentice, how big of a threat that is, do you want to remove it right now?
Yes. Yeah, I think you kill it.
I think you toss the Eviscerate.
You just launch an Eviscerate at it, just chuck one in.
Do you like to play, like, a little bit more on curve and also develop the deadly poison. Not really, right? With the, there is already that attack. Yeah,
what?
The dagger already attacked.
Yeah. And then
No. I just realized it was like...
Yeah, the images kind of block that the deadly a little bit. So I think you just eviscerate and pass. Try and just play Tomb Pillager the following turn. The only other play is like Fan Dagger, which I'm not a fan of. Like, if there's no images, I could get behind playing the Deadly here just to clear the next minion that comes out.
Just a 2-mana backstep here.
The old ping pass.
Yeah, but I mean, you also...
It makes no sense to play more mirror images, yeah. Right?
No, it doesn't make any sense.
Yogg's already in the opening hand. I'm kind of liking how this game's developing.
Yeah, the matchup's kind of weird. Like, Rogue's worst matchup in Hearthstone is probably Freeze Mage, right? And Tempo Mage starts out as Tempo Mage, and then it also runs Ice Block, and then the Cabalist Tomes, and sometimes Conjurers or things like that. But it just kind of turns into Freeze Mage as the game continues.
Yeah, just burn
or it
your
plays like
face.
The Freeze Mage, this matchup. Like it
yeah,
plays
yeah, it
like
plays
the
like the Freeze Mage by the end of it, which is why I think the matchup's favored for the Tempo Mage. It just kind of has that shift into Tempo Mage into Freeze Mage, especially with the one that Eloise has built being the more Chinese variant with the Cabalist Tomes and the Ice Block.
Mm-hmm. I really want to go Azure Drake with the Blast next turn, but you kind of need to do something with this 4-mana turn. And maybe it's just also fine to drop the Azure Drake here.
You've seen the Eviscerate.
Yeah.
So there's a,
and you have mirror images up. It's pretty hard to get through both of them. Prep Fan, or not Prep Fan, Spell Power Fan is one of the ways you can get through it.
Well, you can go Thalnos Fan, Prep Fan, clear the board, push 5, draw 2 cards. That's pretty nuts.
Yeah. Use a lot of your good resources, though. Your prep.
You use 2 cards, right? Because you use Thalnos and Prep
Fan. I do like
keeping
the 5/4.
I really like Thalnos, Prep Fan, make a new dagger, go for the 3/2 points.
Okay.
I really like that a lot.
I can get behind that as well. I don't know.
It's you also deal 5 damage in the face. You make that 3/1.
Yeah. You take 4 extra damage, and you don't cycle a fan, though. I think cycling a fan is really strong, just because your hand's pretty garbage. And
I mean, you also want to redagger still with this 1/1.
True. You want to get that other. I guess it depends off the draw. If you get a Drake here, then I would dagger and kill it for sure. But without a Drake here or without any sort of substance in your hand, I feel like you got to cycle this fan.
Okay, yeah. I can see that too.
If you get gadgets in and that Tomb Pillager dies, you win the game. So.
You also want to draw this hand. Like, you want to draw into more minions.
Yeah.
Arcane Explosion. Not the greatest matchup for Arcane Explosion. Well, there's the teacher that sometimes does a lot of work, so.
Sure.
Also, there is the consideration of the Forgotten Torch with the Arcane Explosion if you want to clear the board here. Instead of like the ping. I'm not even sure if you want to kill Thalnos.
Yeah, I think you want to keep it alive.
Yeah, like not giving the extra card draw, right?
Yeah.
It's also like a target for like Arcane Blast if you need to activate stuff too.
Oh, alright.
Use the Arcane Explosion.
Spell power is scary, I guess. That means, I guess, she's assuming she won't be able to kill it the following turn.
What is better than...
And that's the game.
No better timing to draw the Guardian's End than just on turn 6.
With the coin and a conceal.
With the coin. Oh, man. That's so good.
There's no way it's
So what do you think
right?
the play is here, Tice?
I think I just think coin conceal is pretty great.
Yeah.
I mean, you can think of more value and like go for like the dagger with an SI.
It
and then
can't
you,
die to Flame Strike. Yeah. There's no way it can
this
die.
That's true. Like not
Flame
Cannon
out of standard.
Yeah.
Aw,
so
poor
is Bomb
Flame
Lobber.
Cannon.
So is Bomb Lobber.
Aw.
Gadgetson's back in full steam. No Goblins and Gnomes cards out there to kill it.
Yikes.
Is there any reason to just prep the if it's not? Well, I mean, nope. Flame Waker can like kill it with like Arcane Missiles, Frostbolts.
You got a Drake though. If you had no Drake, then I would understand like doing it potentially. But with Drake already in hand, you have reload if the Flamewaker shenanigans comes out to get it.
Cabal's Tome. You did draw Catalyst the Tomp. Flamewaker.
Yeah, Flamewaker doesn't feel good here. So, and Catalyst Tomp, I mean, if you don't play anything here, the spells from Rogue also get a little bit weaker. They can't use it on anything.
That's true.
They can use it right on your face.
Yeah, well, that's true, but...
I guess we can go on the...
You've seen both fans, so images might be decent.
Yeah.
Maybe you could stop a cold-blooded Gadgetson from doming you in the face.
Not that decent against Skulker, but yeah.
well, if your opponent's playing Skulker and their gadgets in Conceal turn, you're real happy.
Yeah,
that's
five mana. Yeah, that's true.
I like the images a lot. Yeah, you want to like just make sure this cold-blooded Gadgetzon doesn't punch you in the face as much as possible.
Yeah, not even that. Yeah, well, as I, Deadly Poison are going to make also good use here.
Life Coach should try and prioritize punching Eloise in the face with this deadly, this cold-blooded Gadgetzon.
Oh. Skulker.
Talking about the Skulker.
SI allows you to cold blood. Yeah. Would you prep anything?
I will start with the cold blood here, see what we draw. I don't know if I want to do that because the 3-2 trades really well in the 0-2 image. Yeah, I like the cold blood. Cool. This one goes face, the Gadgetzon. Yep. So let's see what we do. Now I wouldn't mind the prep of his face here.
Why?
You don't like it?
I don't like it at all.
I like cycling to Leroy as fast as possible.
I don't want to give this deck too much time.
Yeah, I don't mind that. Also, what if you draw Van Cleef?
If you draw Van Cleef, it's really good, yeah. But even then, you miss 8 damage to be able to play it eventually.
You can't do the 8 damage.
Although, you don't miss 8 damage because you eviscerate the images, but... I don't know, eviscerate's just such a great removal spell that I don't mind it.
And now we draw Van Cleef, and not missing any damage.
I like that. That's a good line of play.
That's he played Van Cleef.
I think he's running out of time.
Yeah, I think so, too. Yeah.
I think Van Cleef was better there.
Yeah.
just a little bit.
Oh, I didn't
that
see
was
one,
yeah,
two,
I
think
3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So that would have been a 14-14 Van Cleef.
Yeah, and he missed the swing on face there at the end a little bit.
Yeah, I'm not sure if he wanted to with Deadly Poison with the second one then, but...
waits for the second one, yeah.
Not sure.
Or yeah, I can understand waiting for the second one, because you have two-turn lethal even if everything on your board dies, right? Out of hand. Because he equips second
but,
deadly.
Yeah, if you attack for 3, you go at 8, then you have 5-7. Yeah, then you're 1 off.
Then you're 1 off, yeah. So I think it's better this way, actually, to hold the deadly. But, the only damage in his deck is Leroy, right? There's no Shiv or anything to make up the 1.
Still, right?
Yeah, but you can't connect it. This is all assuming your board's dead, right? Mm-hmm. That's what the dagger hold helps you play around. If your board dies, you can still set up lethal for the following turn. So I like it. All right, I think we're going to clear the board, play SI7 and a giant Van Cleef, and set up lethal.
I was thinking if there is like any benefit of like going also for Pillager Van Cleef.
Now you can do 8-8 Van Cleef.
Can also go.
You backstab SI, Deadly Poison.
Yeah, then your Deadly Poison goes phase, and
then Van
really
Cleef.
You lose the 2 damage from the SI, so you don't guarantee lethal. Mm-hmm. But you don't really want to play this.
I mean, you can ignore the Flame Waker, potentially.
I kind of maybe like the... Nah, that if you had 1 more mana, then backstab... Nah.
What about backstab Tomb Pillager, Deadly Face, Edwin, and you...
Don't kill it.
Don't kill it.
Ooh. Yeah, I mean, I can see it.
Set up the guaranteed lethal next turn without him to rely on drawing Leroy if your board dies. But I can also... You can also pretty much safely assume your board's not going to die.
Well, for now, but you know what can happen at turn 10, so I really like to, like, still trying to do it in 2 turns. With an possible Yogg, you never know what can happen. And I feel we are in a good spot to try to dodge the Yogg.
Yeah, Eloise is in a position where she has to get, like, Ice Block.
Yeah. And then Yogg has to heal her.
And clear the board.
And clear the
board. And play, get some secrets, maybe, like.
Yeah,
that's not secret. Impossible.
No. But you ask a lot from Yogg.
With Yogg, it's always possible.
I think that's it.
Yeah, like Fireball Arcane Blast is not really appealing. It kills, but you die on board.
Yeah, typically speaking,
that's a series.
It's pretty tough for Rogue in that matchup, but sometimes you get Tomb Pillager into Gadget Coin Conceal.
Yeah, well, really great start also before that. The Mage was also a bit of the slow start with the Apprentice Mirror Image.
Yeah.
And passing afterwards, so.
All right, Life Coach, come over here, man. Oh, I guess I'll scoot down. Put on the headset. Mm-hmm. There you go.
Hey, guys.
How you doing, man?
I'm doing good, but my 12-12 Edwin is not doing good.
Ran out of time. That's one of the instances where not enough time and the sabotage. It's okay, man. You still won. You
was it like 12-12 or
I think 14-14.
Oh, what the fuck? Oh, okay. Oh, my God. Oh, no.
Yeah.
And I played the 3-3 instead, right? Oh, that's very cool.
It's all right. So, Life Coach, you go into the series and now you win 4-1. Was there any kind of thing, like special notes that you kind of made specifically for Eloise that you're playing against her? Have you guys even played since the ATLC match back then?
No.
Okay. No. So this is the first time.
That was like a good. I remember the 15th.
Okay. Yeah.
But it was my fault. I mean, like my flame tongue deploy was also questionable.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. But cool. Yeah. You're sometimes better lucky than good. So
lucky and good.
Mm-hmm. There you go. That's a good combination.
That is. That's the deadliest of combinations. Of course, talk to me about your next match. You're up against a person you may have heard of. He's actually the reigning
really
Europe
tough
champion.
Opponent.
It's Tice. So now you're going up against Tice, another G2 team kill. Pretty sad, but at the same time, it's pretty cool to think that a G2 member will guarantee get to the finals.
Awesome. Yeah. Tice, awesome. We are in the finals. Yeah, no, of course, it's a very bad feeling, too. Mm-hmm. I hate to play against teammates, so... But, I mean, it cannot be helped.
Yeah, we also practiced then so much together, and now it's like, now you...
Yeah, exactly.
All right, cool. Do you guys have any questions for Life Coach?
No, everything. Good, I mean, if I had questions, they were already asked the last 30 bars.
For sure, you guys talked a lot.
I was just going to ask about the Flame Tongue play, but he already brought it up,
Yeah, I mean, I think it was correct not to take the Imgang boss out. But
really?
I should have maximized the damage. Yeah, because it costs
so
much.
You would have been left with Flame Tongue Totem and then Healing Totem, Taunt Totem. Against nothing.
You got traded 2-2 in a 1-1.
You put,
it's also
you put
like
the Flame Tongue Totem between the 3-2 and your 0-2, your Spell Power Totem. You trade the 3-2 into the Imgang boss.
Yep.
You trade the 0-2 into the Doomguard so it dies. And then you have the 1-1 totem, which trades into a 1-1. And then that dies, allowing the other totem to kill the other 1-1. And then it heals itself back up because it's the healing totem.
I think I didn't have...
That was the board.
I should look it back, but I was thinking to maximize the face damage. I don't lose anything. But I didn't even do that. Like, I think, maximized like 4 more damage by doing that, and that would have also been enough. But I will definitely watch it back.
Okay.
All right, cool. So Life Coach moves on to the semifinals, defeating Eloise, and that's going to mean an all G2 semifinal. Really looking forward to it, because I would like to see both of you guys go on. Next match, we're going to have Zalay versus Naaman. I believe Zalay is the last standing member from America. So let's see if he can continue to take it. If not, we'll have to say better luck next time for that region of North America. For now, we'll take a break. When we come back, more C-Story Cup 5 action.